Warm welcome to this webinar on strengthening and scaling up ECD initiatives through South-South cooperation. My name is Marta Santos and I am your moderator for today's discussion. This is the third thematic webinar hosted by the Community of Practice on South-South Cooperation for Children. The community is a joint initiative of UNICEF, the International Policy Center for Inclusive Growth, IPC-IG, and the UN Office for South-South Cooperation. It was launched early this year in February 2018, and it is hosted in the socialprotection.org platform of IPC-IG. The community aims to bring together practitioners from different sectors who promote and support South-South cooperation for the purpose of advancing the rights and welfare of children and achieving the SDGs. We invite those of you who are not yet members of the community to join us. Our first webinar, which took place in May of this year, tackled the issue of water, sanitation, and hygiene. The second one, held in June, was on South-South development tools and innovations that support the achievement of the SDGs. Next, please. Today's topic is South-South cooperation's added value in expanding and strengthening early childhood development solutions and successes. About 43% or 250 million children under 5 years of age in low and middle income countries are at risk of not attending their attaining their development potential because of extreme poverty, malnutrition, and lack of proper care. The effects of these deprivations reach far beyond the individual lives of children and affect families, communities, and the development of nations. In response, UNICEF's ECD programs support parents, caregivers, service providers, and communities to ensure that all children, especially the most vulnerable, get a fair start in life. In today's webinar, we have three speakers who will present projects showcasing good practices and solutions in ECD that are being shared through South-South cooperation, highlighting the value of South-South cooperation as a powerful and low-cost modality to scale up sustainable ECD initiatives. As I mentioned, my name is Marta Santos, and I am the Program Manager for South-South Cooperation in UNICEF, based in UNICEF headquarters in New York. Prior to this assignment, I was based in Geneva in UNICEF's Regional Office for Europe and Central Asia, working in the area of partnerships. And prior to that, I worked in Zambia and Mozambique in the field of education. Next, please. Our first presentation will showcase a South-South cooperation initiative between Brazil and Sao Tome Príncipe aimed at improving access to and the quality of preschool education. It will be presented by Maria Ballotta, Deputy Representative in UNICEF office in Sao Tome Príncipe. Ms. Ballotta has 12 years of experience in different program areas in UNICEF as well as in other organizations. Prior to this assignment, Mariavittoria served as early childhood specialist in the UNICEF Regional Office for West and Central Africa. Before that, she held the position of education officer in the same office. From 2007 to 2009, she was posted in Haiti as UNICEF Child Protection Officer, and before joining UNICEF, Mariavittoria worked at an Italian NGO based in Equatorial Guinea, specialized in the area of community mobilization and protection. Next, please. Our second presentation is on Cuba's bilateral cooperation with Bolivia and Honduras on integrated ECD approaches. It will be presented by Maria de los Angeles Gallo. Ms. Gallo is the National Director of Early Childhood at the Ministry of Education in Cuba. Maria, we are very happy to have you with us today. Ms. Gallo holds a bachelor's degree in education and a master's degree in education sciences, specializing in preschool education. Her professional activity is broad, encompassing different levels of the national education sector. She was an early childhood teacher, sub-director and director of an early education daycare center, director of the preschool department at municipal level, director of the Latin American Center of Reference for Preschool Education and currently the National Director of Early Childhood Education in the Ministry of Education in Cuba. In relation to South-South cooperation, she has directed and participated as a panelist in seminars, congresses, and international events, as well as provided expert advisory support to Mexico, Venezuela, Guatemala, Colombia, Panama, and Iran. Maria's presentation will be in Spanish, and our colleague, Victoria Colamarco, program manager in UNICEF's office in Cuba, will kindly help in the translation during her presentation. Next, please. And last but not least, we will hear about Turkmenistan's cooperation on multi-sectoral early childhood interventions involving several countries in the region. It will be presented by Sashli Duman, who is the health officer at UNICEF's office in Turkmenistan. Ms. Duman started her career at the Family Medicine Department of the State Medical University in Turkmenistan. She then worked for the World Health Organization, where as a national expert, she supported the Ministry of Health in modeling of the first primary healthcare clinic in the country. From 2000 to 2008, she managed a nationwide community health education program of the US Peace Corps. Sashli initiated and coordinated the establishment of the first e-hub for all master and PhD candidates of Turkmenistan. Ms. Duman joined UNICEF Turkmenistan in 2011 as health officer. Within child survival and development, she led the support to the Ministry of Health in establishing early childhood development, early identification of development difficulties, and early intervention. Next, please. While these three programs are distinct in their focus, approach, and potential, a common feature that links them is how they shape solutions that are homegrown in countries from the global south, which are then scaled up across the world using various South-South modalities. This webinar will take a closer look at these elements and discuss the results and the potential to further expand access to them and ensure sustainability using South-South cooperation. We will be able to take one or two questions after each presentation, but there will be a Q&A session after all three presentations. Please feel free to submit your questions in the chat box anytime during the webinar. And with this introduction, let me now hand over to Mariavittoria to make the first presentation. Mariavittoria, you have the floor, please.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Marta. And thanks to everybody. Thanks, colleagues in HQ, to giving us the opportunity to share the experience of São Tomé Príncipe. I hope you can see me. Hi, everybody. We are in our office in São Tomé Príncipe, and I'm lucky enough to be here with Mariana Ruth Leal, who is our education specialist in UNICEF São Tomé Príncipe. She is the real mind and the thinking behind our South-South experience in São Tomé Príncipe. So I wanted her, of course, to be here with us. I will be doing the presentation, which has been prepared by her with our national counterparts, and she will be with me for any additional questions and support we might have during the presentation. So maybe just to give a very quick background on the initiative in São Tomé Príncipe. São Tomé Príncipe is an island. It's made of two islands, actually, São Tomé and Príncipe, in Central Africa, and is covered by the Western Central Africa Regional Office for UNICEF. In São Tomé Príncipe, one of the priorities of the program since 2012 has been early childhood development, and particularly also early learning. Access to early learning in São Tomé Príncipe is pretty good compared to other countries in the region. The average for the region is actually around 20%. And São Tomé Príncipe, as of today, has more than 70% access to preschool education by young children, 3 to 5 years old. We can move on with the slide, which can help us going into the deal of the South-South cooperation. So, of course, the considerations of the high level of access to preschool didn't stop UNICEF to think forwards of what was needed to really provide quality and equitable access to early childhood education. So while UNICEF continues to boost for universalization, we also wanted to have sort of a more systemic and strategic
approach to early learning. And the issue of quality early learning came out as being critical for the UNICEF and national counterparts and the Ministry of Education. The access was good, has been good for years, but we saw that we needed to strengthen the quality of the provision. And therefore, the South-South collaborations with Brazil came up as the ideal solution, because Brazil, and in particular the partner we identified, which is the Catholic University PUC, proved to have known experience in the development of a quality early childhood education. Let's start from the result, though, so that we start on a energetic point with the results that we achieved so far. São Tomé Príncipe, thanks to UNICEF support and through the South-South cooperation, was able to develop a new national curriculum for early childhood education, which focuses on learning and development skills for children aged 4 or 5 years. I will specify why this age group later on. The curriculum that was developed thanks to these initiatives is play-based and includes a support mechanism for children and for teachers as well. 90 trainers in the country have been equipped for cascade training, covering the full country, including important workforce such as coordinators and supervisors. Productions of the new pedagogical material also took place, and this was to support the teaching and learning with the new approach. The support material is actually very innovative because it is around 8 modules of early learning skills and competencies and 320 activity cards on different competencies. So today, São Tomé Príncipe is equipped with an activity bank of different activities teachers can organize and use for their daily work in the classes. Finally, we were able, thanks to the collaborations with Brazil, to of course look at the most innovative elements of quality early learning, but also to adapt it to the context of São Tomé Príncipe and value the assets and the skills and the materials that already exist in São Tomé Príncipe. Next. Here are just some examples of the material that was developed. So the theoretical, of course, basis and booklets that was developed. And then you can see it also behind me is this activity board. This is used in classrooms for teachers to organize their week and their days with activities. I have with me copies of the 320 activity
Hello, we lost Mariavittoria.
Use and refer to. I hope you can hear me fine. I can see that there is just maybe some issue with the video, so please let me know. Otherwise, I can move on. Yes, we can move on with the slide as well, please. So that's the example of the material I was mentioning. And here again, some of the examples of other additional tools that teachers use. So the booklets, the which serve for a pedagogical basis, and then again, the cards that I was showing that, of course, we can provide for more details. And we can move on with the slide. Thank you. So just maybe quickly also to give you an idea of the typology of areas that we have been looking at. So it's, of course, is the language, some early maths and literacy movements, and of course physical development and the social emotional skills, and of course arts as well, and expression by children. These are the areas that are in the different cards and for which we organize the activities. The modalities we used was a partnership cooperation, as I said, with PUC, with the Brazil University we identified, of course, with the coordination and support from UNICEF Brazil, and UNICEF in São Tomé Príncipe provided financial and technical support. There was also overall oversight and coordinations by the regional office in support to the work of the country office in São Tomé Príncipe. Next. The partners involved include the Ministry of Education, of course, and Culture, the preschool workforce, the teacher training workforce, the two UNICEF office plus the regional office, the World Bank, which supported specifically with the exchange visit of the São Tomé and Príncipe team to Brazil. They financed the visit. There were a couple of visits, Ruth, right, if I am correct. There were two visits to Brazil, which involved not only the political level, but also, and the decision makers at the ministerial level, but also the teachers themselves, a group of 40 teachers that was able to travel to Brazil and see and get a sense of how Brazil is doing with the experience of quality early learning. That is actually a very interesting modality, because in terms of how involving partners, because we were able to, the office in São Tomé Príncipe was able to ensure participation at all levels, not only at the upstream level, but also of the real first right in the field, you know, in workforce involved. The first respondent, as I can say, as I would say. Finally, the one specific department of the university, which is the Department of Art and Design, and this, we wanted to specify this because PUC was chosen not only because of their experience in the content development, but also in the overall design of the material, which was very important for the material to be captivating, for the material to be inspiring for the teachers, and therefore the two elements in the university made a lot of difference. And finally, the Department of Design and Education in the same university. Next. So how we used the South-South collaboration, it was used through all the stages of the implementation, from the joint development of the project back in 2013 with an inception mission, to the establishment of a pilot project between 2014 and 2016. And on this point, I would like to also to talk about the fact that UNICEF São Tomé Príncipe was part of a regional initiative for rollout of early learning assessments, which took place in more than 10 countries in West Central Africa. The early learning assessment took place in 2014 in São Tomé Príncipe and allowed for a readjustment of some of the material, readjustment of the some of the content in line with the results of the early learning assessment, which functioned a little bit as well as an evaluation of the work. Several missions took place between 2014 and 2016, namely aimed at establishing a scale-up of the pilot and strengthen the teacher's capacity in the use of the curriculum, following the feedback we got from the team. In 2017, we got the generalizations of the curriculum at the national level as one of the main outcome. And of course, from 2013 to 2017, PUC and UNICEF Brazil were involved in the communication and the support to UNICEF São Tomé. Next. Added value of this program for the São Tomé Príncipe experience, clearly the some part of the context and the reality of the two countries are similar and led to strong adaptations of the approach in the material. The fact that the two countries speak Portuguese and have Portuguese material was an incredible richness for São Tomé Príncipe, which is in a region where majority of the countries speak French or English. Therefore, the horizontal or south-south collaborations within the region is not easy. We do have other Lusophone countries, but not enough for the exchanges with regards to the quality of preschool. The other countries we are talking about, they don't have, for example, the same level of access to preschool, apart from Cabo Verde, that has a good rate as well. The two teams, the exchange visit strongly motivated the São Tomé team. So to organize those visits was very helpful. They stay engaged, they got engaged by seeing the conditions in which teachers were working and some of the solutions that Brazil found. There was a true cooperation between the two teams, between the Brazilian team and the São Tomé team, and it has been very participatory at all levels, as we said, not only at the ministerial level, but also with regards to the teachers and the end users of the material. As I said, the language was an asset, and also the academic support, which led to a strong element of action research, so continuous improvement of the work that was being done in São Tomé Príncipe. And of course, the capacity at the local level were strengthened in a sustainable way. And as of today, the teachers are working with part of the skills that they learned from the experience from Brazil. So that guaranteed sustainability of the initiative. Next, please. I think we are done. That was the last slide. So thank you so much. I'm just looking at Ruth, if she wants to add something in Portuguese, as we have Spanish speaking also panelists. Please, Ruth, go ahead. I will translate anything. Qualquer cosa que você queira especificar.
Não, eu acho que foi tudo muito claro. O que eu só queria dizer que é a vantagem da cooperação do Sul-Sul, é para permitir que os países possam expandir as suas experiências com base nas outras já consolidadas e assim ganhar tempo. Isto é o valor desta parceria baseada nas experiências dos países que já têm o seu sistema muito mais avançado. Com certeza, se São Tomé e Príncipe fizesse o seu trabalho sozinho, levaria muito mais tempo a ter essas conquistas. Menos de 5 anos, nós podemos criar as bases todas e temos hoje uma reforma curricular, toda ela sustentada não só no currículo, mas em normas, na formação, na produção de materiais, para que realmente esta qualidade e o fortalecimento das competências das nossas crianças sejam realmente boas para garantir o sucesso delas no ensino básico.
Obrigada, Ruth. So Ruth was also strengthening one of the other lessons learned and advantages, I would say, of the South-South cooperation in the case of São Tomé Príncipe, which is the gain of time. São Tomé Príncipe, by exchanges with a country that had experience already in this field, again, in 5 years, was able to accomplish the review of the curricula in a sustainable way. If São Tomé Príncipe was to do it alone, maybe it would have taken more time. So that is a true added value of this modality. That led to a reform of the curricula, which is felt throughout the system today. And I wanted to add also that last Friday, the new education law was approved, and it includes the inclusions of preschool as part of the basic system of education. So preschool is becoming mandatory in São Tomé Príncipe for all children, and that we are happy UNICEF could support with some elements of the quality we were talking about. Thank you so much. I think we used all our time, and thank you again for the opportunity, and obrigada, Ruth, for a specific story.
Thank you, Maria.
Over to you.
Thank you, Mariavittoria. Do you mind putting on your camera again? Because we have a couple of questions for you. So it would be nice to hear, to see as well, you and Ruth. Thank you so much for that presentation and also for highlighting the power of South-South cooperation, both in scaling up results, as well as you said, gaining time in terms of achieving the results. Two questions. One, what were the challenges that you encountered in developing the South-South cooperation with Brazil and the university? And the other question is, if there are countries who would want to learn from the experience in Sao Tome Principe, what would be the modality for that? As well as if other countries would like to connect with a university in Brazil, what would be your recommendation for other countries to be able to do that? Over, please.
Marta, so if you allow me, I will translate also for Ruth quickly, so that we can also get the opportunity of hearing from them, especially on the challenges. Ruth, a questão seria também sobre desafios, não? De colaboração com o Brasil, se há alguns desafios, e depois a segunda é se um outro escritório de UNICEF quer trabalhar com PUC, que seria nossas recomendações para aprender deste trabalho e também da colaboração com a UNICEF. Então, primeiro para desafios.
O grande desafio que nós deparamos ao longo deste processo todo é a combinação das agendas, das nossas necessidades e a disponibilidade. Trata-se de parceria, não se trata de consultorias, portanto, há todo um ajuste que tem que ser feito nas agendas académicas. E isso nós conseguimos, mas com muito custo. Portanto, as formações davam-se nos períodos das pausas letivas. Outro desafio que nós conseguimos, hoje as tecnologias estão muito avançadas, fizemos recurso ao ensino à distância para reforçar as competências, porque eles não estavam presentes no terreno. Portanto, era todo um trabalho de fortalecer permanentemente as capacidades para realimentar, né, o processo, já que estávamos numa experiência piloto. Outro grande desafio tem a ver com a questão da dimensão territorial. Se nós conseguimos isso, adaptando às especificidades regionais, isso deve-se ao tamanho do país. Num país, numa dimensão maior, pode ser que o resultado seria mais desafiador.
I'm gonna go ahead with translating this first part on the challenges, if you allow me. There are three main challenges that Ruth was mentioning, and one is related to the availability, the timing availability of the partners. This is not a consultancy, Ruth was saying, this is a partnership. So we had to adjust with the calendar and the timing of the university and the availability of the teachers and professors in university and the experts was of course limited to their duties in the university. So the project needed to adjust it, to be adjusted with the academic year, for example, to allow for support missions or for direct support. The second thing, which is more also of an opportunity, but can be a challenge in some countries, is the advances with technology that today allows us to have distance learning, for example, for the teachers. That was a modality that in time was used to support continuously the teachers and the workforce that was part of the project. Thirdly, of course, the size of Brazil is different from Sao Tome and Príncipe, but it was adapted very well to the size of Sao Tome. Now, one thing to be taken into account is this peculiarity of the territory. In a country like Sao Tome, maybe this works well because it is easy to reach out to the workforce and to monitor and to follow up. Maybe in a country that is larger, this kind of modality might be a challenge. So that also might need to be taken into account. Segunda.
Porque a PUC e como se algum país tivesse interessado. A vantagem de uma cooperação académica é pelo fato da língua não ser uma barreira, embora para nós fosse um aspecto positivo, a competência técnica e científica existente, portanto, um país anglófono, um país francófono, não seria uma barreira. Segunda vantagem da PUC é o fato de ter essa dimensão de ligar a educação à parte do design, porque toda a pequena infância é desenvolvida na base da ludicidade, dos materiais lúdicos, isto é que faz a diferença de um ensino pré-escolar atrativo e criativo. Eles têm essa valência lá dentro, uhum. O design. E mais, um projeto dessa natureza, eles envolvem todos os estudantes. Com base nesse projeto nosso de investigação, foram os estudantes que fizeram toda a produção dos materiais, ao mesmo tempo que se desenvolvia, os estudantes faziam todo esse trabalho de maquetização, com base na nossa realidade. Toda a gente, não sei se eu posso ver aqui,
sim,
consegue identificar. Portanto, essa é a vantagem da PUC e que eu aconselharia qualquer um país que quisesse desenvolver materiais pedagógicos criativos, lúdicos, ligados à realidade, com base na investigação-ação, a PUC tem um perfil ideal para apoiar esta.
Mas outro escritor do UNICEF teria que contactar diretamente a PUC? Ou pode contactar o UNICEF São Tomé, UNICEF Brasil?
Eu sugeria que fosse a ponte UNICEF Brasil, para fazer esta ponte, de forma que fosse uma experiência transnacional, né?
Claro, claro. So Ruth was also stressing some of the advantages, of course, of PUC as a partner. That you know, even though it's a Portuguese speaking university, they are fluent with the English and French, of course. So that's good for other countries. And she was overall suggesting that we reach out to UNICEF Brazil for, as we did in UNICEF São Tomé, to get in touch with the university. Of course, UNICEF São Tomé Príncipe is available for more information and details if other countries want to learn more or have a look at the material that was developed. Overall, what Ruth was saying is that the skills we found in PUC were excellent for this kind of work because they have the experience with the design, they have the experience with material that is attractive, that is creative, and they had a full team, not only at the academic level in terms of teacher and professors, but also the students themselves helping out with the design of the material for São Tomé Príncipe. So that that was also a very rich exchange. Over for us.
Thank you again, Mariavittoria and Ruth, for that excellent presentation. We learned a lot from you today. I also want to mention that this experience will be published in the UNICEF and UNOSCE publication, the South-South in Action, that we are expecting to release in November 2018. So for our second presentation on scaling and strengthening ECD initiatives through South-South cooperation, we have the opportunity to hear from the side of the government, and we have Ms. Maria de Los Angeles Gallo. Ms. Gallo, you have the floor, please.
Marta, this is Victoria. I'm going to do a I'm going to take just 30 seconds to say that we are truly honored and privileged to have today Maria de Los Angeles with us. The school year is not currently in session, so she's on vacation and she's joining us today to do this presentation. And we just want to highlight the great value that we place on our partnership from our UNICEF office in Cuba, on our partnership with the Ministry of Education and the Directorate of Primary and Preschool Education. So,
Victoria, thank you for
over that, to Maria de Los Angeles, and
it's indeed a privilege. Thank you.
And over to Maria de Los Angeles, and from now on, I'll be acting solely as a translator.
Sí, buenos días a todos los presentes, y saludo a todos los que nos acompañan, y por favor, dale las gracias a los organizadores que invitaron a Cuba a esta actividad. Para comenzar.
So good morning to all the participants and thank you for everyone who is joining us and particularly to the organizers that selected Cuba as one of the experiences to be highlighted today.
Para comenzar, quisiéramos decir algunas condiciones que aseguran la atención de la primera infancia en Cuba.
To begin, we would like to set out some of the contextual issues that are guaranteeing the rights of children in Cuba.
Lo primero es que en Cuba la atención a la primera infancia es una prioridad y además que es financiada por el Estado a través de un presupuesto nacional de un 21% del presupuesto nacional cubano.
Early childhood is a priority for the Cuban government and is financed by the state of Cuba with a budget amounting to approximately 25% of the national budget of Cuba.
Los servicios de atención que se proporcionan es a través del Sistema Nacional de Educación y de Salud.
Services are provided through the national education and health systems.
Son fortalezas en el trabajo en Cuba, la atención y el trabajo intersectorial, la participación de la familia y la comunidad y la prevención en todo momento.
Multisectoral work as well as engagement with communities and families are some of the elements that strengthen the ECD program in Cuba.
Todo esto ha permitido determinados resultados que quisiéramos exponer y son los que han asegurado que Cuba pueda dar una asesoría o una colaboración a otros países.
All these elements are crucial to the success of ECD programs in Cuba and are also the factors that allow for Cuba to be able to provide a model for South-South cooperation in other countries.
Los servicios de atención de educación de calidad y gratuito en Cuba son accesibles a todos los niños de entre 0 y 6 años.
Education services in Cuba are universal and free, and they are accessible to all children from 0 to 6 years old.
Esto ha permitido una cobertura de atención de un 99,5, la cual se desarrolla en dos modalidades de atención educativa.
This results in a high coverage of education services in Cuba of 99%. And 99%, and also is based on two different ECD modalities.
Entre las dos modalidades tenemos la modalidad institucional que se desarrollan en los círculos infantiles, se atiende el 18,3% de niños y el grado preescolar que se encuentran en las escuelas primarias donde se atiende el 13,2%.
Within the institutional modality we have the círculos infantiles which are catering to 18.3% of the population, and then in the preschool within primary schools, 13% of children, 13.2% of children are covered.
Cuba desarrolla una modalidad no institucional mediante el programa educativo y social llamado Educa a tu Hijo, donde se atiende el 68% de los niños y sus familias.
And Cuba also has a non-institutional modality, which is more of a community-based model called Educate Your Child, in which 68% of the children attend to.
Existen otros resultados desde el punto de vista de aprendizaje que también podemos decir que son determinados resultados que aseguran también el desarrollo que el país ha tenido en la primera infancia.
There are also some monitoring and evaluation results that assure that these successes are maintained over time.
En el monitoreo realizado en el año 2014, en el nivel de desarrollo alcanzado por los niños, se obtuvo el 98,8% de cumplimiento de todos los indicadores evaluados.
In the 2014, the monitoring and evaluation revealed that the level of development achieved by children was 98.8%. In compliance with all the indicators that were evaluated.
En las encuestas de indicadores múltiples por conglomerado, las MICS, el indicador de aprendizaje, de manera general, el índice de desarrollo temprano fue de un 89%, pero el de aprendizaje específicamente de un 96,2%.
Within the multiple indicator cluster survey in 2014, it was found that the education development indicator was reaching 89%, but the learning indicator reached 96.2%.
Creo que algo importante ha sido el impacto del programa Educa a tu Hijo que se comenzó a aplicar en el año 1992 en los resultados de la educación primaria.
In also measuring the impact of this program, it's important to take into account the results seen also in primary education.
Se disminuyó en primer grado de un 8,3 a un 3,9% los alumnos sin objetivo vencidos en primer grado.
Within the data collecting part of this, it was seen that the students decreased their results of non-compliance or non from 8.3% to 3.9%.
Y en el caso de los repitentes de segundo grado, de un 7,5 a un 1,6.
And those who were repeating the grade, this percentage was decreased from 7.5% to 1.6%.
Estos son algunos resultados que se pueden exponer del trabajo en Cuba. Y el último es la experiencia, el próximo, que Cuba tiene en la colaboración realizada en distintas asesorías que Cuba ha realizado.
These were some of the results seen in the program, and from now on we will be talking about the collaboration initiatives from Cuba.
La contextualización del propio modelo cubano Educa a tu Hijo que se realizó en siete países donde ustedes lo tienen presentado acá.
We have contextualized the non-institutional model to the seven countries seen in this slide.
Por eso, eso ha permitido que Cuba pueda realizar una cooperación sur-sur que tiene experiencia y que aunque tenemos muchos retos que todavía hay que seguir trabajando, pues ha posibilitado realizar cooperación en otros países.
This has enabled Cuba to be able to transfer its model to other countries, and although we still have many challenges, we continue to improve our model and take it to other countries.
En esta cooperación, Cuba realiza o pone en práctica una estrategia conjunta para la cooperación.
Through this modality, Cuba puts forward a joint strategy for South-South cooperation.
Donde se realizan diferentes acciones, comenzando casi siempre, vamos a decir casi siempre, porque tiene algunas adecuaciones que podemos después explicar. Por el diagnóstico inicial.
Almost always, with some exceptions that we can go into later, we start by an initial diagnosis or an assessment.
Diagnóstico inicial que se realiza tanto por los asesores cubanos como por la contraparte, por los especialistas del país que estamos asesorando.
And this is done jointly with the Cuban specialists and advisors and those of the country that we are advising.
Porque lo primero que se debe de realizar cuando vamos a trabajar una asesoría en otro país es conocer las características de la atención educativa de ese país, sus necesidades, sus intereses, sus costumbres, sus tradiciones.
The first thing we try to do is to get to know the issues of education in the country that we are visiting and understand its challenges, its tradition, and its culture.
Y por supuesto que es importante también realizar un estudio de las legislaciones que en este país se llevan sobre la primera infancia.
And we also need to do a study of the legislation related to our early childhood.
Un segundo aspecto es la conformación de un equipo intersectorial designado, por supuesto, por el país que estamos asesorando para recibir la asesoría.
And there's also a multi-sectoral team appointed by the country that is receiving the South-South cooperation that works closely with the Cuban specialists.
Este es un aspecto muy importante, que es el segundo aspecto, porque el país tiene que seleccionar las personas que van a recibir la asesoría, estas personas quedarían preparadas para posteriores acciones que se tienen que realizar.
This is a very important element because it is the country that designates the specialists who need to be trained, who will later scale it up or begin a rollout process in the country.
El aspecto número tres es el conocimiento de las modalidades de atención en Cuba, sus concepciones que la sustentan y su metodología de implementación.
The third also aspect is the knowledge and understanding of the Cuban model, its characteristics, its challenges, and its implementation.
Esta acción puede estar en el número tres o puede estar al principio. Hay otras asesorías que Cuba ha realizado que el país que se va a asesorar ha planteado primero venir a Cuba y eso se accede.
Sometimes the countries request to first understand the Cuban model before the contextualization, and in this case, countries are very interested in coming here to understand the model first, and the Ministry of Education accommodates for that as well.
Teniendo en cuenta los aspectos anteriores, se realiza el número cuatro, que es la definición de la estrategia de cooperación.
Taking into account the previous factors, then we define the cooperation strategy.
Aspecto muy importante porque es donde se concreta con el país que vamos a asesorar lo que necesita, qué aspectos se van a trabajar, qué temas, qué líneas de trabajo quieren realizar y por eso es muy importante la acción de la contraparte que vamos a realizar el asesoramiento.
And this is a very important element because this is where we define more concretely what specific actions we are going to undertake together, what initiatives and what are going to be the action plans for the cooperation.
El aspecto número 5 es la selección de los asesores cubanos.
And then we move on to element number 5, which is the selection of the Cuban advisors.
Porque una vez determinado los aspectos que el país nos solicita, en lo que se va a realizar, en lo que se va a trabajar, puede ser la modalidad institucional o la modalidad no institucional, Cuba selecciona los asesores, asesores con conocimiento, asesores que han trabajado en la práctica y por supuesto que lleva una preparación sobre el país en el cual vamos a trabajar.
Once we have defined the needs and the interests of the country that is receiving the cooperation, then we can select the specialists that are more knowledgeable, with the most experience, and who are practitioners in the fields that are going, that will also need training to understand the context of the country that they will be supporting.
La próxima acción es ya la implementación en el país donde se hizo la colaboración o se va a hacer la colaboración. Y lo primero son acciones de sensibilización con todos, con personal del gobierno, con otras personas que pueden también participar, con docentes, con educadores, con familias.
And the sixth aspect is, of course, the in-country implementation. And for this, the first element is to ensure that everyone has the correct knowledge on, and everyone is involved. It's like a campaign to get people to be sensible about the issues, and this is from a broad stakeholder base, not just involving teachers, but other actors in society.
Después de estas acciones de sensibilización, pues, se realizan acciones de capacitación. Ese personal que va a trabajar en esa implementación, hay que capacitarlo, hay que prepararlo, de los diferentes niveles, tanto desde el nivel nacional, desde el nivel a nivel de estado y luego en las comunidades.
And then the next step is to do a capacity training process that involves people from multiple levels, both from the ministry level to also the community-based practitioners.
Una vez que el trabajo ya está preparado, que se han también realizado todas estas acciones de sensibilización, se trabaja ya en las comunidades seleccionadas. Por ejemplo, en el caso de Honduras, que Cuba hizo un asesoramiento, se trabajó en dos estados y en esos dos estados en dos comunidades. O sea, en cuatro comunidades se trabajó en el caso de Honduras para después empezar la generalización.
And once these issues are covered, then we select the areas where we're going to... implement the program. And for example, in the case of Honduras, we chose two communities and then two other communities.
En la visita de visitar familias, de capacitar a estas familias, de capacitar a los que van a trabajar con la familia. Esas son acciones muy importantes que tenemos que hacer en las comunidades donde se va a efectuar el trabajo.
Once in the communities, we also engage with the community members and the families in making sure that they understand the need for this program and its advantages. So we're trying to do also an outreach program to get their buy-in into all this.
En este aspecto también se realiza un diagnóstico de esta comunidad porque hay que conocer qué característica tiene la comunidad, qué trabajo hay que realizar, qué acciones tenemos que hacer allí en esa comunidad. Por lo tanto, también se elaboran determinados materiales, programas, guías, todo lo que sea necesario para poder comenzar ya la implementación en el trabajo con la familia, que en este caso es la asesoría que Cuba realizó.
We also carry out an assessment for the particular communities to understand their issues, And with the results of those assessments, we also elaborate materials to make sure that the families are, the materials that we're giving to families are culturally appropriate and with are effective in ensuring their buy-in.
Después de realizada esta acción, que realmente lleva tiempo porque es en la comunidad, porque es con las familias, porque es con los con las personas que son allí líderes comunitarios, entonces comienza la implementación del programa que se está llevando allí, que realmente lleva o un fortalecimiento de la modalidad de ese país, porque hay países que tienen su modalidad y nosotros lo que hacemos es fortalecerlo con otras acciones, o la organización de una nueva modalidad.
This aspect, this last aspect takes a bit of time because we need to understand the community and decide and define what are going to be the elements of intervention. Sometimes the community already has a model and we go in and strengthen it with different elements coming from our model.
En el caso de Honduras, la nueva modalidad que allí se trabajó pues se llama Criando con Amor. Es una modalidad dirigida a la familia, a preparar a la familia para educar a sus hijos y también yo creo que fue muy importante en esta comunidad el trabajo que se realizó tanto con las madres como con los padres.
In the case of Honduras, for instance, we developed jointly this model called Raising with Love, in which we sought to educate families, and a critical aspect of this one was to make sure that we work both with mothers and fathers.
Fue también una característica en el caso de Honduras, unas sesiones de trabajo que allí se hicieron, muy particulares de ello, que le llamaron Creciendo Juntas.
In this case, we also had joined some sessions that were developed with cultural sensitivity that were entitled Growing Together.
Estuvo dirigida a que las madres participaran en la elaboración de juguetes.
And it sought to involve mothers in the design and the development of toys.
El rescate de tradiciones culturales.
To ensure that they were based on cultural traditions.
Elaboración de alimentos nutricionales.
And also the food.
Y también la construcción de un parque rústico para los niños de esa comunidad.
And we also built a small park, an amusement park for children in the community.
La última acción que contempla es las acciones de seguimiento y evaluación.
And the last element of this is the follow-up and evaluation.
Que esto nos permite comparar a partir del diagnóstico inicial que se realizó cómo ha sido el seguimiento, los resultados que ha tenido la implementación del programa en la comunidad.
And this also is contrasted with the initial assessment and allows us to see the results from this initial assessment to the implementation of actions within the community.
Hay un último aspecto que es la formación de especialista que puede estar en cualquier momento de la estrategia, está puesto acá al final, pero puede estar en cualquier momento, pero que es muy importante para que quede preparado el personal en el trabajo que posteriormente ese país va a realizar en la generalización del programa.
And the last aspect we're noting here is also related to the capacity strengthening of specialists to ensure the sustainability of the program. But this capacity strengthening can take place within any of the other elements or steps in this process.
Lo anterior puede mostrar los siguientes éxitos y logros en la cooperación.
And it will also ensure the success and the achievements within the cooperation.
Lo primero es que hubo una mayor sensibilización y comprensión de la importancia de la primera infancia como oportunidad para el desarrollo integral.
In this case, in the case of Honduras, we saw a greater sensitization and understanding of the importance of early childhood as an opportunity for integral development.
Lo segundo, la comprensión de la necesidad de formular y aplicar políticas de atención a la primera infancia.
The understanding of the need to formulate and implement policies for the the integral attention to early childhood, with the participation and mobilization of state actors, as well as civil society, including families and communities.
Lo tercero es que está o se organiza un compendio metodológico con documentos básicos para la implementación de las nuevas modalidades o el fortalecimiento de las ya existentes.
And we have the availability of pedagogical documents that would allow for the implementation of new modalities and the strengthening of existing ones.
Por supuesto que lo máximo que se quería es ampliar la cobertura de atención educativa a la primera infancia, y eso trae elevar los niveles de desarrollo que alcanzan las niñas y los niños, así como la preparación de las familias y la participación comunitaria.
The highest goal in this issue was also to increase the coverage, which also results in increasing the development of children through the participation of families and communities.
Y bueno, hubo un reconocimiento, realmente un incremento del reconocimiento y satisfacción de las familias y las comunidades.
And we also know with great satisfaction an increase of recognition and satisfaction of families and communities.
¿Qué planteamos como valor añadido?
We also have added value.
Consideramos que esta cooperación que Cuba ha realizado ha fortalecido las instituciones que aquí en Cuba propician la colaboración internacional, tanto el Ministerio de Educación como el Centro de Referencia Latinoamericano para la Educación Preescolar, que le llamamos CELEP.
We see that our own institutions that are carrying out the South-South cooperation have been strengthened through the experience, in particular in this case, the Ministry of Education and the Center of Reference for Preschool Education of Latin America, CELEP.
Nos ha traído también una cultura de asesoramiento y un reconocimiento internacional de la calidad científica y humana de la asesoría cubana.
It has fostered a culture of advising other countries and also has resulted in international recognition of the quality and the human aspect of the Cuban advisory services.
Ha ratificado y ha mejorado la práctica educativa en Cuba, porque esto ha posibilitado que algunos aspectos del trabajo que hemos desarrollado, pues ha hecho que Cuba también analice nuestra práctica educativa. Por eso yo creo que ha sido importante el análisis del mejoramiento también de algunos aspectos en nuestra práctica educativa.
These experiences have also led to our own analysis of our educational practices and a feedback loop to ensure that these experiences are also influencing the way we do the education services in Cuba.
Y el fortalecimiento de las relaciones con UNICEF para facilitar los procesos de colaboración entre los diferentes países.
And the strengthening of our relationship with UNICEF to facilitate these cooperation processes with other countries.
Quisiéramos decir, para concluir, que UNICEF ha tenido un papel siempre decisivo en las acciones que hemos realizado en esta acción de cooperación sur-sur, como facilitador, con el acompañamiento sistemático, que yo creo que ha sido muy importante para poder realizar esta tarea que Cuba efectúa.
And to conclude, we want to highlight the role of UNICEF as a decisive partner and a continuous facilitator that allows for the constant follow-up to ensure the results of this process and to also support the Ministry of Education in providing these services in other countries.
Bueno, damos las gracias por escucharnos.
With this, I thank you for listening.
Thank you very much, Maria de los Angeles, for that excellent presentation of a very good program, and also highlighting the different values of South-South cooperation. In particular, I noted that you mentioned that in addition to providing technical assistance to other countries, Cuba also continuously learns, and that is the spirit of South-South cooperation. We have two related questions for you, and also Victoria, thank you for that very clear translation. We have two related questions for Maria. One is, one of the things that governments mention to us when the demand from other countries is high is how do they meet the demand? And so it seems that in your presentation, you mentioned that you were able to provide all this support to other countries. So the question is, how did you resource that? Is that a challenge? And how is the funding for these different initiatives managed? Is it co-shared or is it provided by the Ministry of Education or by the requesting country? And related to that is the second question, is that I'm sure that there are many other countries outside the region who would like to learn from your experience and to receive technical assistance. And if that would happen, what would be the procedure for requesting support from Cuba? Over, please.
Thank you, Martha. Can you, I noted the two questions, but there was one aspect before the financing that I couldn't quite gather. Can you repeat that, please?
It's the capacity. Many governments mentioned that the challenge when the demand is high from other countries is that they could not meet the demand because there is no capacity either in the government to provide the technical assistance. But it seems in this example that was done very well. So we would like to know how did the Ministry of Education resource that? How do they manage to provide such technical support to many countries?
Great, Martha. I already translated that. María de Los Ángeles will respond now.
Sí. En el caso de la primera pregunta que nos hacían sobre la financiamiento, en este caso Cuba pone los asesores y Cuba coordina con el país el trabajo a realizar. Pero realmente todo el tema del financiamiento lo pone el país, que en este caso nosotros vamos a realizar la asesoría. O sea, el país es quien aporta el financiamiento de acuerdo a la puesta de acuerdo de ese país con el Ministerio de Educación de acá de Cuba.
So in regards to the financing question, we would like to note that when Cuba is negotiating this cooperation modalities, Cuba provides advisors and all the coordination work. And it is the recipient country that finances all the related expenses to this.
En ocasiones, como en este asesoramiento que hicimos en Honduras, UNICEF apoyó también con ese financiamiento.
In the case of Honduras, which we were discussing during the presentation, we would also highlight that UNICEF provided some financial assistance as well.
Sí, en el caso de otros apoyos que hay veces que otros países nos solicitan, o sea, digamos, la formación de maestrante, de maestrías, o en este caso el apoyo también, el asesoramiento a determinados actores de gobierno, pues exactamente igual se hacen memorandos de entendimiento, o sea, se realiza entre ambos países una puesta de acuerdo y lo que en todos los casos Cuba pone el especialista, el mejor preparado, el que nos solicita el país y el país que se va a realizar la asesoría es quien pone ese financiamiento.
In relation to your question about other countries outside of the region, we sometimes have requests for advising and training. And for agreeing on this, we usually develop a memorandum of understanding with the country that is requesting the assistance. And again, Cuba provides the specialist that meets the demands of the country, the recipient country, and the recipient country finances the expenses.
En el caso de la pregunta que nos hacían de la capacidad que puede tener Cuba con asesores cuando existen varias demandas, hasta la actualidad hemos podido cumplir cuando lo han solicitado. Habíamos explicado que la selección de estos especialistas se hace de acuerdo a lo que nos están pidiendo, de acuerdo a las necesidades, de acuerdo a lo que el país necesita. Por lo tanto, Cuba tiene hoy una, o sea, un personal calificado, preparado, formado, que puede asumir las solicitudes que en ocasiones nos han hecho de asesoría.
In relation to your question regarding the capacity of the ministry vis-a-vis the demand of other countries, we are happy to say that we have been able to meet the demand so far, and this is also due to the fact that we select the specialists taking into account the specific requests and the needs of the country that is requesting the advisory services, and that we have qualified staff that is able to provide these services in other countries.
Importante que en ocasiones los países solicitan docentes, educadores que están en la práctica. Y es lógico, Cuba también, o sea, ha accedido a eso. Y siempre lo que tenemos algún profesor o algún funcionario, ¿no? De algún nivel municipal o provincial o nacional que está en esta asesoría, pero cuando nos han solicitado que sean docentes que están en la base o que trabajan en la comunidad, Cuba accede a esta solicitud.
In some cases, countries request teachers who are practitioners, and in many cases, they request for teachers at the municipal or provincial level, and in other cases, they request teachers who are based in the community. And in all these cases, Cuba is able to accommodate its requests and provide the assistance.
Porque lo más importante en esta colaboración que Cuba realiza es dejar preparado al país. Los nacionales de ese país o los educadores de ese país deben quedar preparados para realizar después su generalización, sus acciones. Nosotros siempre pensamos que cuando se va el asesor cubano no debe de parar lo que el país viene realizando. Y eso ha sido una muestra en la contextualización que Cuba realizó del programa Educa Tu Hijo en otros contextos, en varios países del área latinoamericana.
It is crucial to us, and the most important aspect of this, for us to be able to leave the national practitioners in the country prepared to carry out these actions. And our philosophy is that none of the initiatives should stop when the Cuban advisor leaves, and this is something that we have noted in many of the countries where we have worked, that this work has been continuous after the Cuban advisory services are over.
Okay, thank you once again, Maria de los Angeles, for that presentation and the response to the questions. We do appreciate the time you took from your holiday to be able to join us today. There are a few more questions from the participants, and we will mention this during the Q&A portion of the webinar. Victoria, thank you again for the clear and excellent translation. And now we move to the third presentation on horizontal cooperation in early childhood development, sharing with us the experience of Turkmenistan. Sashli, over to you, please.
Hello, everyone. Thank you very much for the opportunity to share our country experience. On the picture, you can see brilliant, beautiful pieces, 2-3 very nice girls in our traditional dresses. This is just piece of a culture for you to have a flavor of it. Next, please. To give you a brief background of the country, mother and child health is one of the most important priority areas. All intervention and identification services have high interest here. UNICEF is the only international agency that supports ECD in the country. We have draft national ECD framework prepared and waiting for approval. And this is the framework that envisions intersectoral cooperation to enable scaling up of family support services in the country. Next. First, ECD centers have started working, two of them under the Ministry of Health, and they already not just provide only services, they also started working as training hubs to prepare ECD specialists. Other centers, they work under the education ministry, and they provide multidisciplinary support for young children with disabilities and their families, and focus on supporting child's transition to mainstream education. Next, please. We have data constraints, though I'd like to share some brief information that we have. I think one slide has missed here. Before I write, yes, one before. blue one. Okay, that's fine. I'll just talk through. Exactly. We have three instruments that have been introduced into the country, and already more than 3,000 children have received an access to the services and have been able to go through the identification whether they do have delay or risks of delay and if they need that additional support services. Early identification services and early intervention services started to be developed in selected ECD areas, and we are planning to use the results of it for the countrywide spread up. Also, parental support is the important area. We had the last mix that shared us with interesting results that only 11% of fathers are involved in child education. Next, please. Okay, so a guide for monitoring of child development, GMCD. The using of it gave us an interesting data telling that 60% out of all children that went through this tool had feeding problems. 30% had inadequate stimulation. 39% had undernutrition. Also, children that were coming to the ECD department center, 64% of all children were boys, and only 36% were girls. And we're not sure what is the cause of this gender disparity. So this is food for us and for further actions. Next, please. We use four modalities for South-to-South cooperation in ECD: study visits, policy dialogue, technical assistance, and knowledge exchange. You can see on the picture there is Professor Etem. She's working with our local specialists and training them in ECD and early intervention. Next slide, please. I will talk about study visits in my next slide. We started with study visits, and we gave an opportunity to key decision makers to visit Turkey, Lithuania, Belarus, Russian Federation, UK. Visit to Belarus enabled people from Parliament, from Ministry of Health, Ministry of Education, and Ministry of Social Affairs to see the module of that used in Belarus under the similar ministries. The participation at the high-level conference on the role of home visiting in ECD in Ankara also boosted the work and helped to gain the political will and have them to take the decision to bring the best practices on ECD into the whole country. Next, please. Next modality is the policy dialogue. I would like to mention about RFQ Institute of Child and Adolescent Health Institute in Armenia that helped our country to develop a national framework for introduction of developmental pediatrics and early intervention, an action plan for the 5 years, 16-20. This basically a guiding document of what needs to be done to make sure that early interventions are in the country. And this document is approved and now under the implementation. Next slide, please. The other modality is technical assistance. Here I'd like to talk about work with Ankara University that started with introductory course on development of pediatrics that our decision makers from Ministry of Health that have received in Turkey at Ankara University. Also is followed with study tour of medical professional, medical university management to Ankara University. This work followed with the team of Ankara University helping us to develop situational analysis and develop a human resource development roadmap. Want to pay attention to the intensive capacity building program that have been initiated and still is going on. Next slide, please. The technical assistance with Ankara University followed with their help in building new services in two districts and three regional level facilities in three regions of the country. The GMCD tool now are to be used at the primary healthcare level by home visitors. Every home visitor will be using it in the future. which means every child will have an access to early identification and intervention. And we have received the Gender Innovation Grant, and now we are to adopt the application, GNCD application, that will be in Turkmen and Russian languages. And every homebased will have it in the tab, and while going to the family, be able to go through the process and have every child be assessed, monitored for his or her development. By using this app and using this tool, we really hope that it will tackle not just ECD issues, but also gender disparities, that to ensure that every girl or every boy has the access, and to empower parents, particular empower mothers, in particular empower fathers, to ensure their involvement. It should not be 11%. And every district of the country has now one person who is responsible for ECD, and we have them trained in basics that they need to know. Next slide, please. So next I want to stop on cooperation with country offices. Three country offices, Turkmenistan country office, Kyrgyzstan and Azerbaijan country office, worked with Ankara University to bring all our ECD specialists together and give them our unique training and development of pediatrics with support of Ankara University. Next slide, please. This work really helped to initiate and build a network of ECD specialists in our region. On the picture, you can see Kyrgyzstan specialists that they have visited our country to learn more about ECD and our experience, and also to get trained in the GNCD package. This actually was the learning experience for both countries, and I'd like to highlight that it was very, very useful. Next slide, please. Cooperation with Early Intervention Institute, St. Petersburg, Russia. A huge bulk of it is going in capacity development, in building early identification and early intervention services under the Ministry of Education. The program includes study visits, trainings, webinars, and supportive supervision. Starting this year, our work has grown up to the program cooperation agreement, and they started their work under the PCA. Next slide, please. The work done by, next slide, by Early Intervention Institute helped to build multidisciplinary service provision at the facilities on the education mandate. The new service is based on child and family assessment and development of the individual plan for the family. And it focuses on comprehensive support and transition of the child to the mainstream education. In addition to child development professional, child development support, it also involves physical, occupation therapy, psychology, and early communication help. And also relevant in service training programs are developed or updated. Next, please. So to resume our work in South cooperation, in Turkmenistan, this really helped to strengthen or develop institutional and technical capacities of Turkmenistan professionals, gave an opportunity for knowledge exchange and sharing know-how, and also it helped to build strategic directions in ECD, understand and choose own modules of family support services, and provide it within Ministry of Health and Ministry of Education entities. Next, please. So this is basically all I wanted to share. Thank you very much for giving me a chance to share our country experience.
Sasi, thank you so much for that presentation. So the question that we have for you, we will fold into the Q&A. So we have received at the moment 7 questions. And I will read them, and we will give all the presenters an opportunity to respond to the questions. But we will also share with you all the questions to the presenters, and written answers could also be provided to the participants who put forward the questions. So one question, which actually we are addressing to you, is on the think tanks. One of the strengths of South-South cooperation is also collaboration not only among governments and the other partners, but also with think tanks and the private sector. You mentioned the cooperation with Ankara University and St. Petersburg. So the question is, how do we strengthen the global collaboration with think tanks so that anybody who would be interested to learn or to cooperate with this university would find it easy? But before I hand back the floor to you, Sachli, let me read the other questions so that we could already proceed with the Q&A. One question is on program effectiveness, and the presenters were asked to comment on how do we assess this program effectiveness of our interventions. Another question is on standardized tools, and how do we, are there standardized tools, and how are these developed, and are these something that we could adopt globally, or something that needs to be adopted based on the country context? Another question is a bit easier, is on the availability of materials online. So the question is if these materials are available online for others to be able to access it. One question is specific on the Círculos Infantiles, if they are daycare centers, and a bit of a description on the Círculos Infantiles. Another question is on the Cuba experience. It's very well appreciated in terms of the systematic and practical application, but the question is to explain a bit more on the methodology for South-South cooperation. In particular, how is the initial diagnosis done, and how is this carried out, and how much time does it take? And also related to that question is, in a South-South cooperation for ECD, what is the usual time frame for such intervention? And the final question is on the development of the materials, if these are applied nationwide, or is it specific to some geographic context. With those questions, let me hand over to, okay, we could start with Sachli, and then we will move to Mariavittoria and Maria de los Angeles. Sachli, over.
Sure, let me start and then I'll give word to other presenters. I probably will talk about your first question about how we can involve private sector. And I think this webinar is the first step to that. So the more we share our experience and show how effective this cooperation is, then the more interest will be involving in this. Also, working with universities and our entities in ECD, our experience with Azerbaijan and Kyrgyzstan was very useful because we had to work with our country offices first, and then one office worked with, was kind of bridge the other country offices with the partner, and share the partner and share the expertise to spread it over the area. That's the first question, and probably I'll step in with the tools because this is something very needed, and having a standardized tool is useful, and it helps to save time. The GMCD tool, the Guide for Monitoring of Child Development, is actually a standardized tool that's been tested within 20 years in several continents. And now it's basically easy to use in every place in the world, though it does require very good training, so to ensure that you can use it properly. That's why, well, we had our country to introduce different tools and instruments and models. That's why our country stopped on this one, because it's free and easy to use, and very effective. So that that is my saying on the tools, I think, and I can give a word to other people to add if they want to. Thank you very much for the opportunity again. If there are more questions, you're more than welcome to email and we will give more information or detail. Thank you.
Thank you, Sashli. Mariavittoria, over to you. Please address any of the questions that have been raised. Over to you, Mariavittoria.
Thank you very much. Thank you. I think a couple of questions that we can contribute to. One is on the material and the use of the material nationwide. First of all, the material is not online, the one developed from Sao Tome Principe, by Sao Tome Principe, but we can definitely share a link with access to the material to those colleagues who are interested. With regards to the use nationwide and some of the challenges in making sure it is adapted to different cultural characteristics, I would say that this is not really an issue per se in a country like Sao Tome Principe, which is inhabited by 200,000 people. Of course, there are still some specificities, but overall, I would say that the country is pretty compact, culturally speaking. And this, in any case, if some of these kind of issues raise, the material is flexible enough to be benefiting from the insights and views of the users. So some of the cards that I presented, excuse me, I forgot to share the web, but some of the cards that I presented actually are empty in the back. For teachers to write down some of the ideas or adaptations they would like to be featured in their program. So that's a way of reflecting as well some of the cultural aspects. Second, on the length of the collaboration, I think for us it has been, here in Sao Tome Principe, it has been results determined. So the development of the material and the training of the workforce. Nevertheless, I think an experience like the one Sao Tome Principe had with South Brazil, with Brazil, foster a lot human relationship as well. And these human relationships with PUC, with UNICEF Brazil, and overall with all the stakeholders are continuous and kept up despite the end of the initiative per se and the attainment of results. So, for example, Rute has to get in touch with PUC last week to ask some informations about part of the material, and they replied immediately and they are in touch, you know, because they have been collaborating together for so many years, and that is still ongoing despite the fact that we don't have a formal MOU continuing as of now. So I would say result determined, having a clear timeline with the results that the South-South is contributing to, but this is fostering, I would say, more sustainable collaboration in time between the stakeholders, at least in our experience in Sao Tome. Thank you, over.
Maria de Los Angeles, you have the floor, please. Miss Gaia, Victoria, are you online? Victoria. Maria, we couldn't hear you.
Hi, Marta. Is it our turn? I'm sorry, but we missed we lost the audio connection momentarily. We are back.
Yes. It's now your turn. Over to you, please. To you and Maria.
Sí. Bueno, la primera pregunta que nos realizaron es qué son los círculos infantiles en Cuba. Los círculos infantiles en Cuba son instituciones educativas que atienden niños de 1 a 6 años. Son instituciones que son atienden los niños también desde la, puede ser desde las 6 de la mañana, según si el padre trabaja y desea dejarlo a esa hora, hasta las 7 de la noche. O sea, siempre la atención en estas instituciones son por educadoras graduadas, educadoras que han sido formadas como educadoras de la primera infancia. Este círculo infantil tiene un currículo con diferentes dimensiones donde el niño realiza actividades educativas y donde su actividad fundamental es el juego. También en estas actividades se realizan diferentes procesos, proceso de alimentación, el proceso de sueño, el proceso de aseo. O sea, el niño que permanece en esta institución a veces por varias horas, tiene todo un horario o un régimen, vamos a decir, de vida organizado para poder recibir la atención educativa en estas instituciones.
We had a first question regarding Círculo Infantiles, which is an institutional educational modality for children between 1 and 5 whose mothers are also working mothers or working fathers. And it's a program that can run from 6 a.m. to 7 p.m. depending on the needs of the parents. And it provides education services with the care and attention and models of trained ECD professionals who are also implementing a full curricula with several dimensions and educational activities based mostly on play and leisure. But in these institutions, also in these educational institutions, we also provide food and children take naps, and they are also take care of their hygiene. And it provides an organized schedule for children to achieve their educational goals.
En el caso de la pregunta sobre el diagnóstico inicial, nosotros habíamos explicado en la estrategia que dentro de las primeras acciones es el conocer el país, o sea, conocer las características del país que se va a realizar la asesoría, sus necesidades, sus tradiciones, su atención educativa que realizan a los niños de la primera infancia. Y a partir de ahí se elabora un diagnóstico, o sea, un diagnóstico en la comunidad donde se va a experimentar, porque es muy importante a partir de esta comunidad que se seleccione, conocer nivel escolar de la familia, conocer niños que son atendidos en alguna modalidad educativa o los que no están atendidos. Importante las características. De enfermedades que allí a veces tienen, alguna problemática, como es la dinámica de la familia en la parte educativa, de diferentes materiales didácticos que la familia tiene para trabajar con el niño. O sea, de acuerdo a las características del país, se elabora un diagnóstico. Diagnóstico que es el punto de partida para poder realizar la implementación en esa comunidad. O sea, nosotros le damos mucha importancia a ese diagnóstico.
The other question regarding the initial assessment or diagnosis falls into the category of the aspect that we were highlighting during the presentation of getting to know and understanding the context in which we were working. As part of this process, we try to understand the characteristics, the needs, the traditions, and we carry out the community assessment to understand many factors, including the education. achievement of families. Services, ECD services, recurrent
para este diagnóstico que es una apuesta que estamos realizando la acción del país que se está
to the timeline, really define
Victoria, Victoria, the audio is not clear at all. Victoria, the audio is not clear at all. Could you try again, please?
Ubicando en el caso de un
María. Maria and Victoria, the audio is not clear. Could we try again, please? Let's see if the audio will become clearer. Could we try again?
About 2 years.
Hello, Mariavittoria. Maria and Victoria, are you online? The audio was not clear. Could we try again, please? Okay. Dear colleagues, we are just waiting for Cuba to get back online. If not, we will see what we can do to get back to the questions. And I think, Victoria, could we try again, please, before we give up? No? Victoria? Calling Victoria and Maria? Okay, if not, we are going to try to get back to Maria and Victoria in Cuba and respond to the questions. And I think with that, I will close the webinar. Let me thank the presenters, of course, Maria Victoria and Mariana Ruth Leal from Sao Tome Principe. Maria de los Angeles Gallo and Victoria from Cuba, and our presenter from Turkmenistan, Sashli Duman. I also want to thank from IPC-IG, Karine and Yannick, who supported this webinar, and from UNICEF, our colleague Raya Kishwar Ashraf, who is the focal point for UNICEF for this particular webinar. Thank you all for participating. We will share with you the Q&A and the responses, and the webinar recording will be available online. Thank you so much. Thank you to all, and thank you to all the presenters. Bye for now.